Tonight, a ruling has been made for the two RCMP officers charged with the manslaughter of Dale Culver. Plus, we speak to the chief of the Nazco First Nation for her reaction to the controversy surrounding the mayor of Quesnel. And the city is updating its decades-old snow removal plans. Good evening, I'm Eddie Huband, and welcome to CKPG News. Our top story tonight, the RCMP officers who were charged with manslaughter against Dale Culver had their charges dropped today in court. Constables Paul St. Marie and Jean-Francois Manette received these charges last year in the case regarding Dale Culver, a man who died 7 years ago following a physical altercation with police. Tommy Osborne spoke to Culver's family following the court session, who say they are appalled that the charges were dropped. Here's tonight's top story.
To call our system a justice system is not true, because otherwise we wouldn't be standing here with no justice today.
That was the feeling of around 100 people who attended a rally outside the courthouse and the following court session regarding the two officers charged with manslaughter against Dale Culver, as a stay of proceedings was ruled by the Crown for Constables Paul St. Marie and Jean-Francois Manette.
When you have RCMP members stepping in and doing atrocious acts such as this, how could they call that justice? How could they call this country a free and just country?
After analyzing forensic data files, the Crown said it couldn't be proven that RCMP caused Culver's death. While one forensic pathologist reported that the physical altercation with police resulted in brain injury, the Crown also got a second report from what it called Canada's top forensic pathologist, which disagreed with the original. The second report said Culver's death was caused by a heart attack due to the acute and chronic effects of methamphetamine use. And while the physical altercation exacerbated Culver's ensuing heart attack, the Crown ruled it could not be proven that the officers dealt any fatal injuries or directly caused Culver's death.
What has happened here is tragic, but one wouldn't have thought that a component of the system would have got this that wrong. As the Crown said, there were no fatal injuries caused by the police. And that's the end of it.
When we hear that a pathologist's report is no longer credible in this court system, there's something very flawed about our judicial system.
There is no reason or doubt in my mind that it is still those RCMP's faults that he is dead, because without that given interaction that night, he would still be here today.
As for the RCMP officers whose charges have been stayed, the National Police Federation says it's happy to close what was a long chapter in the lives of the officers.
This exoneration comes too late, and the court of public opinion is relentless. It's cast them as if they were guilty, and today there were over 100 individuals protesting the charges being stayed, even in the face of now clear medical evidence that they were not responsible for Mr. Culver's death.
For those lawyers to say that it's hard for the families and for the RCMP to have to put their lives on hold for these past 7 years to deal with this case is not okay. Imagine having your life have to come to a stop for anything to happen and still nothing happened 7 years later.
Disappointment and heartbreak don't even begin to describe what was felt in that courtroom, as the judge ruled there would be a stay of proceedings due to insufficient evidence to 100% justify the manslaughter charges. However, the family of Dale Culver says they will continue to advocate and fight on his behalf, which could include an independent investigation in the future. Tommy Osborne, CKPG News.
So a dramatic day at the courthouse today. Tommy Osborne joins us now to follow up on that. So, Tommy, you were in the room, obviously a very tense atmosphere, a very controversial ruling. Can you tell us a little bit about what it was like inside that courtroom?
Absolutely. I mean, tense for sure. There's really no shortage of words that could be used to describe the emotions going through. Fury, disappointment, dread, frustration. Just some of many feelings once it became official that the manslaughter charges would be stayed. Following the court proceedings, a Lily, Dale's daughter, stood up and shouted at the lawyers and the judges saying that how would you feel if that was your father in that situation? The following quotes I'm going to read here are verbatim. This one from a 21-year Indigenous military veteran. He said, I've served this country for 21 years. Do better. Others, as they were leaving the room, had comments like, truth has its own demands of justice. natural justice will come? And how do you sleep at night knowing you killed someone's child? The judge ruling over these proceedings earlier commented, saying that he knew this wasn't the popular decision, but he said he can't take emotions and public ruling into account in his judicial process.
Very interesting stuff. Now, it's my understanding that these are two of the officers being charged, but there's still another trial coming up in May for three other officers involved. Can you explain what that trial is going to be about?
That's correct. Again, that was two of the five. The other three, that is going to be, it is Sergeant Bayani Cruz and Constables Arthur Dahman and Clarence McDonald. They're all facing charges of obstruction of justice, and this is for allegedly trying to take phones away during the incident and trying to delete footage off of people's phones of bystanders that were trying to record. Lily said she hopes that more comes of that upcoming trial, as she and the rest of Dale's family and other communities, of course, would also all told me they want to see somebody held accountable. And they're hoping that accountability comes in this following trial in May for obstruction of justice. I would like to add here again that the judge did comment on this feeling of wanting to hold somebody accountable. He said that he knows this feeling exists with Dale's family and community members, but again, he said he can't take emotions into account when going through the judicial process, when going through the court proceedings.
And the evidence, obviously, that was put forward and everything. Yes, I understand. Now, moving forward, does Dale Culver's family or does anyone else plan on pursuing this further? Will there be an appeal of any kind?
There has been several people pointing to that idea for sure. Hereditary Chief Namox of the Wet'suwet'en Nation certainly pointed to that idea, saying that Dale's family is the appeal. He said that Dale's family is living proof that this must end. Hereditary Chief Namox, when he says this, he means what he says is unfair treatment of indigenous people by policing and by the justice system. Lily also pointed to possibly pursuing an independent inquiry. It's possible that we may see that in the future. Right now, of course, there's another trial coming up in May. This was just fresh today. So there's a lot going on. It's too early to say definitively what future actions will be taken, but it's possible that an independent inquiry may be in the works sooner rather than later.
Right. All right, Tommy, thank you very much for that report. We appreciate your insight. And we have some breaking crime news now. A police standoff has been taking place at the Bon Voyage Inn in Prince George. It began this afternoon at about 3:30 p.m. with at least six officers with guns drawn towards one unit at the motel. The police dog service team is also outside the unit with Prince George RCMP asking the public to avoid the area until what they're calling the police incident wraps up. No word on those inside the unit or the reason for the police presence. We will have an update on this story as soon as we receive more information. As we told you on Wednesday, Quesnel City Council meeting was filled with emotion on Tuesday as the actions the mayor and his wife and a controversial book being distributed were discussed again. And it has deeply strained the relationship between the city and the Nazco First Nation. Chief Leah Stump of Nazco told Adam Burles her thoughts on where reconciliation can go from here.
Chief Leah Stump of the Nazco First Nation was one of many present at Quesnel's council meeting Tuesday and told council how much the actions over the last 2 weeks regarding the controversial book being distributed by the mayor's wife have done for truth and reconciliation in the community.
We deserve better than having to come here to prove that our people went to residential schools, to prove that we were hurt, that we were broken. We deserve better.
Chief Stump says that she is unsure if Mayor Ron Paul can do anything to repair the relationship between him and Nazco.
I don't know if he can say anything or do anything to repair the relationships because the trust is broken.
The mayor's wife, Pat Morton, and contributor to the book Grave Error, Frances Widowson, spoke at the meeting, and the latter's comments caused Stump and others to walk out of the meeting.
Does it agree that this is misinformation because there is no evidence of unmarked graves at the Kamloops Indian Residential School?
It still hit hard for myself and my community members of just the disrespect they were showing in their words and in their statement. I didn't want my elders who were sitting there in the front row to continue to listen to what she had to say. So I just got up and led them out. They didn't need to go through that again.
Stump says that what has transpired in Quesnel in the last 2 weeks should not be happening in 2024.
For it to go this far in 2024, for us to be attending a city council meeting where we have to listen to others defend the book, like, how does it even get that far?
Despite calls to step down, Mayor Paul has said that he intends to stay on as mayor until the next election in 2026. Adam Burrows, CKPG News.
The relentless death toll due to toxic drugs in BC continues, with 177 more people dead in February. BC's coroner service says that while it's an 11% decrease from the same month last year, it's still the 20th consecutive month that more than 175 people have died. The coroner says drug toxicity is the leading cause of death in BC for ages 10 to 59. Vancouver, Surrey, and Nanaimo have the highest number of deaths, although some of the highest death rates are in the Northern Interior and North and Central Vancouver Island. The Mercury Report is a decade-old report setting out standards for snow removal. But during council's budget deliberations, those standards came under scrutiny, with budgetary requirements becoming excessive in the minds of some sitting on council. Cheryl Jan reports on a possible update to the report.
Snow clearing is always a contentious issue for the city to deal with, and it costs a bundle. And that budget is oft debated by council at length during budget discussions. The current snow practices were determined by something called the Mercury Report. But that report and the standards set out are 10 years old.
Myself and Councillor Bennett said, we need to look at it. Do we need to have people plowing snow on the stat days? You know, what are the costs of those, the service levels, the amount of snow that falls before we're supposed to grade? So a number of things are coming back because it's not sustainable. Administration said we spent $11 million last year. We're trying to get a breakdown on that, but costs keep going up and up and up.
This past winter is a shining example of how our winters have changed.
A lot has changed in 10 years. It's, you know, when you're taking into consideration things like climate change, our winters are going through a lot more freeze and thaw. The cost of doing business just continues to increase. And we have a duty to ensure that we are doing everything we can to keep taxes and the amount that we are billing our residents in checks.
As a result of the Mercury Report, new practices were set in place. When at least 7.5 centimeters of snow falls over a span of 24 hours, it's what the city calls a snow event. If a snow event happens, the fleet is mobilized, plus any contracted equipment, until that snow finally stops, regardless of whether it's a stat holiday or not. And this city is home to the Cadillac of snow removal.
There's always a demand that we could always do better, and we hear that from residents. But I think we also have heard over the last few years loud and clear just how great of a job our teams do with snow removal. I think if you look at some municipalities, Calgary, for example, they don't plow residential streets. There's a lot of municipalities, if not most municipalities, don't do things like opening up the end of driveways.
This is the time of year when street sweeping is in full force, but even that adds to the bottom line.
We never included in the snow budget picking up the sand and all that in the spring, which works out to, I think, $600,000. That used to go to snow removal. So I think we can look at a combination of things, but we just can't keep, you know, raising taxes to pay for snow removal, especially with the climate change now.
The plan is to have some possible options in place for the next budget round in the spring. Cheryl Jan, CKPG News.
Northern Health is warning the public about several instances of fraudulent phone calls claiming to be from the Northern Health staff. Northern Health says that call recipients are told they've won a prize or a free home safety inspection. Northern Health is advising any business or individual who receives an email or phone call claiming affiliation with Northern Health to carefully check the origin of such solicitations before providing personal information or making any purchases or donations. Shifting gears now, a class at UNBC is aiming to hear from citizens in Prince George about the cost of living in our city. Adam Burrows has more.
Students in a Canadian public policy course at UNBC are conducting a survey to find out more from people in Prince George and their experiences with costs of living.
Within this course, we have been doing this ongoing research assignment. Right now, we're trying to figure out how people are dealing with the cost of living, if it's different in Prince George versus the rest of Canada, and then what demographic is kind of experiencing the cost of living more and who it's affecting the most.
After all the survey results are collected, the class will be compiling everything into a final report.
We plan on doing a report, and we hope to enter it into potentially a few contests when we can.
Around 200 people have filled out the survey, but more demographics are needed.
We do want more people to take the survey. As many results as we can get will provide an even greater sample for us and provide us with the ability to go further with the research if we have that higher level of responses. So if people are able to take the survey, that would be amazing.
The survey closes at midnight tonight, and a link to the survey will be available on our website, ckpgtoday.ca. Adam Burrows, CKPG News.
More from UNBC. The Northern Sports Center basketball court is getting a much-needed facelift. It's part of the usual maintenance, but it has been a while since work has been done. And it's a matter of safety.
It's a facility that sees a lot of use. The Northern Sports Center is the home of the UNBC Timberwolves, and its floor is getting a facelift.
So basically, they will sand it down, strip the finish, sand it down, update the paint, and then put a new finish on top to make sure that it is safe and, athletes will stick to it when they move around in the appropriate ways. And essentially, that's what they're going to do.
But it's not exclusively a Timberwolves facility. Right now, BC Judo is setting up for a major tournament, and athlete safety is top of mind for the director of athletics.
The current floor is seeing some wear and tear and showing its age, per se. So athlete safety has become a concern in the last couple years with how slippery it has become. As floors start to wear down, the varnishes come off, the dust settles, and so it's definitely time for a refurbish, per se.
The university has applied for a $100,000 grant from the Northern Development Initiative Trust. But regardless of the success of that grant application or not, the job has been put off for too long.
As time goes by, we look for ways to maximize other funding mechanisms. So, grant applications, sponsorship, that kind of thing. So we can really maximize what we do with the building and the facility, and try to at the same time minimize those costs being passed on to the members.
That application recently got support from City Council, but the university is also looking for some other help.
There is a great marketing opportunity here through sponsorship. We're looking for an organization who might be interested in sponsoring through naming rights on the court floors. So lots of opportunity there to align with the NSC brand, the Timberwolves brand, and benefit from some of the traffic that comes through the NSC, which is quite significant.
The work will get underway in late July and into early August and will have no impact on sports camps or events. Cheryl Jan, CKPG News.
As of this morning, the lowest gas price in Prince George was sitting at $1.629 per litre at Costco. That's also the lowest price in the province right now. Manitoba currently has the lowest fuel prices on average in the country at $1.421 per litre, while BC has an average price of $1.945 per litre.
CKPG Sports is delivered by Domino's. Try one of our delicious stuffed cheesy breads, paired up with chicken, pizza, pasta, or dessert for just $8.99 per item.
The Prince George Spruce Kings kick off the postseason tonight against the Penticton V's. Anthony Correa caught up with the team to preview the big matchup.
It was a forgettable regular season for the Prince George Spruce Kings. The team finished with the second worst record in the BCHL and the worst record in the Interior Conference. But with the league losing a team last year, it was still enough to qualify for the postseason, as the team will be matching up with the Penticton V's in the first round.
Yeah, we've been preparing for this series for a while. I think 2 or 3 weeks now we've known who we're going to play against. So it's been good to kind of nail down our systems and have a plan for Friday.
Despite two opposite records, the Spruce Kings aren't selling themselves short in this series. Knowing they'll be facing Penticton for 2 weeks has allowed the team to play stress-free hockey, a mindset that will also be carried into Friday's game.
There's no pressure on our group. We haven't played a meaningful game in a long time. I'm excited to see how we do. And we'll make adjustments as we go. I think as long as our effort's there and our consistency's there for 60 minutes, that's all we can ask for.
And don't be surprised if Prince George steals a game or two right away. The V's come into this series having lost 4 of their last 5 games, all on home ice, while the Spruce Kings have played well to close out the regular season.
The last month, I think we've just been really focused and preparing for the playoffs. We've known for a bit who we're going to play, and I think that's helped us try some things out and just get dialed for this team.
Puck drop for Game 1 goes Friday, April 5th at 7 p.m. Anthony Correa, CKPG News.
The TSX is up 213 points to close at 22,264. The Dow Jones is up 307 points to close at 38,904. And CN Rail went up $1.44 to close at $176.30.
Good evening again, everyone, and happy weekend. We're going to see lots of sunshine for our weekend, especially through the early half. Saturday looks really nice, starting things off tomorrow with nothing but sunshine for the most part, and then an increase in cloud a little bit as the day goes on. And we do have some instability to talk about as well. But our look back today was great. Lots of clearing where we are. Most of the cloud was sort of south of us. So not seeing any real major disturbances impacting us. There is one hitting the north coast going into Saturday morning, so tonight and tomorrow morning. But for us, it's just sunshine and then a mix of sun and cloud by the afternoon. Very slight chance that we'll see some showers or flurries tomorrow night. Back to sunshine on Sunday. And then the bulk of the next system that's expected is really the timing. Probably Sunday night for us, we could see a pretty good chance of precipitation going into Sunday night and early Monday. But otherwise, it's dry and sunny. 11 degrees, Fort St. John. It was a bit of a cool and unsettled one today, but tomorrow looking good. And 12 for us, 16 in Kamloops. Beautiful. Starting to clear out there and through the day tomorrow and into Sunday as well, and down through the south coast. Yes, more showers on the way. Burns Lake will see some showers as well tomorrow. 11 in Mackenzie. Fort St. James will see mostly clouds and a few sunny breaks, and then lots of the sunshine even south of that. So down through Vanderhoof and Quesnel, 14 degrees and lots of sunny skies. So as I mentioned, a wet one along the west coast tomorrow. It'll be a pretty cloudy one and almost foggy through Edmonton tomorrow. So it has been very unsettled the last couple of days. Not a lot of precipitation tomorrow, but certainly going to see some cloud cover. Through the prairies, some instability moving in. 13 degrees, though, still is where the temperature will sit. 7 in Montreal, 6 over in Halifax, and even cooler in St. John's with lots of precipitation towards the east coast. Chance of showers into our early next week, and really it's Sunday night and Monday that we'll likely see it. Going forward, our overnight lows, by the way, are still a little bit cool, so keep that in mind. But daytimes don't look too bad for the weekend. The Burns Lake forecast, though, very cloudy and rainy, and even seeing some flurries for the weekend as well. So chances of on and off throughout your next few days for sure. It's a different story in Mackenzie, though. Much drier, 11 degrees tomorrow. Sunshine followed by the clouds just ahead of that next system. And then cooler in the afternoon on Sunday. We are looking at a few showers or even snow flurries moving in Sunday afternoon, evening, and into Monday. So McBride will have some cloudier skies to start next week, but the weekend looks great. 12 degrees tomorrow. Quesnel, lots of sunshine tomorrow, and then more of a sun cloud mix for the remainder of the weekend. Quite breezy to start off next week, but all in all, a calm weekend. For us in Prince George, colder tonight, minus 5, bit of a wind chill out there too. 12 degrees, mostly sunshine tomorrow. A mix of sun and cloud by the afternoon hours. And then we have a very slight chance of precipitation tomorrow night, but it's really more so Sunday night. And you can see there on Monday that we have a few extra showers moving back in.
CKPG Sports is delivered by Domino's. Try one of our delicious stuffed cheesy breads, paired up with chicken, pizza, pasta, or dessert for just $8.99 per item.
Judo BC announced Prince George would be hosting the 2024 Judo BC Provincial Championships, and this weekend marks the beginning of it all. Anthony Correa has the details.
The 2024 Judo BC Provincial Championships are set to take place this weekend at the Northern Sports Center. Over 350 athletes from across the province will be participating in the event, 17 of them from the north.
It's pretty exciting. We haven't had a big tournament like this in Prince George for quite a few years now. So many people from our club are going to be competing. Many people from the lower mainland and other parts of BC are coming up. And yeah, we're just really excited to be hosting it.
This event serves as a qualifier to compete at the 2024 Canadian Open Nationals this May in Montreal. A final tournament to put the finishing touches on your technique and moves.
This is an important tournament for a lot of athletes to kind of try things out before nationals. It's a way to like up your confidence. If you do really well at this tournament, you'll be feeling ready for nationals. And if you don't do so well, it might be a bit of a confidence downer. So lots of people will be aiming to do really well at this tournament.
The event will take place at the Northern Sports Center up at UMBC. A special thing for athletes to have a tournament in their hometown and be at full strength when the weekend kicks off.
Throughout the year, the kids travel across the province, and from the north, we're traveling 8 to 10 to 12 hours to get to a tournament. We are exhausted when we get there. We try and let the kids sleep as much as we can. So being able to be on home turf is a big deal. So it's really inspiring that these kids get the chance to do a lot of this stuff.
The U8 to U12 event will start Friday night, while the rest of the tournament will take place all day on Saturday. Anthony Correa, CKPG News.
All right, there was lots of NHL action last night, and we bring you the best of the best in tonight's CKP3 with Anthony Correa.
Starting with a nice effort.
Paul Perfetti in the corner. Been watching him closely. Perfetti gets a pass. Regina scores!
Cole Perfetti with a great effort before setting up Nikolai Ehlers as he goes 5-hole on Dustin Wolf. Next, bank shot.
Tried to feed Severson. Oh, that one banked off the wall. Marchenko with his 21st to tie last season's total. Outstanding effort there, beating Sorokin, and the Jackets have tied it up for the second time.
Kirill Marchenko uses his skill to bank the puck off the goalie's mask and into the back of the net. Cheeky stuff. Finally, Panthers continue to roll.
Good on him. Here comes Tkachuk looking for more. The feed, the shot, they got another one! Sam Bennett snaps it home! And the Panthers are lowering the hammer on the Sens. It's 4-0.
Holy loose moose.
Matthew Tkachuk drops the puck and Sam Bennett rips it, posting in. The Panthers keep the offensive onslaught coming as they take top spot in tonight's CKP3.
That's all for tonight, folks. Thanks so much for joining us as always. We did it. We made it to the end of the week. Enjoy your weekend. And your last look tonight is the Hammond Park basketball court. Open for business now that it's spring. Have yourselves a great weekend and we will see you Monday.